privilege to have you all here today. I'm the professor. This is a pretty good turnout for a Labor Day weekend. These are the hardcore history buffs. We like them. I now have the opportunity and the pleasure to introduce you to Lance Kingmeyer, who is the president of Grant. And it was a long time ago that somebody told me it wasn't Grant's plural. Grant Cottage and Lance, thank you very much.
Again, thank everybody for coming here. It's a holiday weekend. Earl brought a little bit of rain, so hopefully you guys dig in because of Earl. And of course, because of Dr. Wall. I'm president of the Friends of Grant Cottage, and again, this is an attempt by the Friends to reach out to the community and begin to share the wonderful history of Grant and his story, a true American story. Just to let you know, we brought in some artists today. J.C. Parker and his wife. J.C. has become our cottage artist, and he has done some wonderful renderings of Grant Cottage that are for sale. We have an artist by the name of Paul Martin. Paul Martin is president of the Rockland County Civil War Roundtable. He's a teacher of art down in Nyack, New York, and he does wonderful renderings, more pencil than anything else. He's got a table out there. I've met a new man today, and his name is Richard Maslowski. He's a sculptor.
Can I use your mic, please?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
I'm sorry. He's a sculptor, and I was introduced to him through Paul Martin. He's got four examples of the sculptures out there. One, of course, is Grant and Lee. He's got a Lincoln. There's a Custer. There's also a Mark Twain. In addition to that, in the far corner by the Civil War Museum display is Ron Sweet. Ron Sweet is a collector of old newspapers, and he brought part of his collection today, which is for sale. Any of these, in addition to that, we have a book author by the name of Mark Seiler. Mark wrote a book on the 115th New York, which is a Saratoga and Montgomery County regiment. It so happens that one of my great-great-grandfathers fought in that regiment. Mark has his book for sale out there. All of these products that are here, if things are purchased, part of the proceeds of the sale go to support Grant Cottage. In addition, we have museum passes that if you purchase a pass to visit Grant Cottage today, you'll get a 2-for-1, you'll get a museum pass that will allow two people in for the price of one. And then later, I will make a strong pitch for membership to the Friends of Grant Cottage. Right now, I'd like to introduce Dave Hubbard. Dave Hubbard is our site manager and runs the bookstore up at Grant Cottage. Dave's a consummate historian and one of the original, our tour guides up there. And he asked to run the bookstore, and he is going to introduce our speaker. Dave Hubbard.
Welcome to everybody. As Lance said, we're very pleased to see everybody here today. In honor of Grant Cottage, in honor of Dr. Wall, who's going to be speaking here very shortly. One of the things that Lance did not mention is available for sale right in the back of the room are Dr. Wall's book, which she will be signing for you after her presentation. Yes, at a very steep discount from the normal price. Also, there will be refreshments served here after the presentation. And again, I have the pleasure of introducing Dr. Wall, so let me get started. She has been to UCLA not only as a teacher, but as a student. She got her bachelor's degree, her master's degree, and her PhD, all from the University of California, Los Angeles. She is now an associate instructor in the history department in the college, and has been there since 1992 as a teacher instructor. Her specialty is in the 19th century history. She teaches courses on the Civil War, She teaches a course on the Gilded Age. And these are upper level classes that she works with. She has received many, many awards. There would be way too many that the list chair wouldn't give her any time to talk. But I would like to mention a few of them. She was awarded a prize for teaching, innovation in teaching, using technology in her classroom. She uses technology in the form of the internet and so on, handouts, pictures, short movies, and this type of thing. She received an award called the Mary, and I hope I get the name right, Wollenskraft Dissertation Prize from UCLA, and for the UCLA Study for Women. And her dissertation was on the biography of a famous woman. She has done the book that we're all here to talk about today, or she's here to talk about, U.S. Grant, American Hero, American Myth. If you have not read it, I strongly urge you to. It's a fabulous, fabulous book. Very, very interesting read. Dr. Law has also written many essays on Grant and on Civil War topics, and has given speeches throughout the country, many, many places. She's received awards from the very famous Huntington Library in San Mateo, California. She has just done wonderful work in the field of 19th century and Civil War history. So, if you'll allow me to, without further delay, I would like to introduce Dr. John Law.
Thank you very much, David Hubbard, for that wonderful introduction. I'm delighted to be here. Good afternoon. This is my first trip to Saratoga, New York. It's beautiful. I guess I don't have to tell you that. It's historic. And today I got a special tour of Grant's cottage, which is also gorgeous. It's in much need of attention, and I hope you will be supportive of that effort. This is a wonderful venue, the New York State Military Museum. I've walked around a little bit before the talk and enjoyed it very much. So I'm very honored to be here. The title of my talk is called The Troubled Legacy of U.S. Grant, and I think you'll find out why that is the title of the talk as it proceeds. Every scholar of the Civil War must at some point try and assess the legacy of General and President Ulysses S. Grant. Quiet. Now, why did it do that? Should I put it a little bit there? Is there somebody to blame in this room? Or what?
Go ahead.
I don't need a microphone. Okay. I'm going to start again. Every scholar of the American Civil War must at some point in his or her career try and assess the legacy of General and President Ulysses S. Grant, a quiet and enigmatic man who emerged the great military leader, the great military hero of the Union. I am not only a scholar of the Civil War era, I have published a book on Grant that examines his place in history and memory. It's entitled U.S. Grant, American Hero, American Myth. Of this afternoon's talk, which should run about 45 minutes, so set your timers, is split into two parts. The first and the longer part begins with a brief overview of Grant's career. I suspect many in this room might know about his career. And so it begins with that, just briefly, and proceeds to how Grant fared in historical memory from the end of the war until really yesterday. And then there's a second and much shorter section, so you know when the talk is wrapping up, that addresses recent, what we in the academic profession called revisionist history. That means history that is changing something very important in American history, telling a new story about it. So I'm going to talk about, in the last part of my talk, how recent revisionist history or scholarship might affect what we can call the troubled legacy of U.S. Grant. Ulysses S. Grant's reputation has undergone dramatic ups and downs, dramatic swings in the 145 years since Robert E. Lee surrendered at Appomattox. There is simply no debate about Grant's imposing status from the end of the Civil War to at least the first decades of the 20th century. He was the Union's greatest military hero. He was praised even by former Confederates for his impeccably generous terms at Appomattox. He became the first four-star general in U.S. history before winning decisively two presidential elections. Very recently, interest in Grant has entered an upswing, and the past decade alone has seen three major biographies, numerous smaller studies, and a PBS documentary in the American Experience series. Now, this documentary is excellent, and I'm not just saying that because I am a talking head in it. It's really, really fine. And if this keeps up, this interest, Grant may well move a little bit closer to the two most popular figures of the Civil War, Abraham Lincoln and Robert E. Lee. And that's always a surprise to some people when I tell them that's my opinion, because I think in popular culture and popular memory, it is Lincoln and Lee both representing the Civil War for most Americans. But you know what? Grant's contemporaries, especially those in the North, where the bulk of the population resided in the 19th century, would have been stunned to know that Grant's lofty position in the American pantheon was not secured for all time. They knew that Grant, more than anyone else besides Lincoln, made sure that the United States would defeat the rebellion in April of 1865. Yet the truth is that Grant's reputation, unlike that of his president Abraham Lincoln, declined after 1900. Lincoln is still the icon for the ages. Lincoln transcended the Civil War, while Grant is consigned to the relative dustbin of historical memory. So let's briefly review his career. A man who had probably been voted at the beginning of the Civil War as least likely to succeed, Grant graduated with a middling record. He did not graduate last in his West Point class of 1843. He was ranked 21st out of 39. He finished the Mexican War as a captain. He had a good war. Unable to bear the monotony and loneliness of post-war military life in California and Oregon, Grant resigned abruptly in 1854. He went to live in Missouri at the farm owned by his wife and his wife's family, his wife's name Julia Dent Grant. He tried farming and a variety of other jobs and failed to flourish in any. When Lincoln called for volunteers in 1861, Grant responded, and he advanced rapidly up the chain of command. In the Western theater of war, those of you not familiar with Civil War history, the Eastern theater of the war is the one that most people pay attention to. That's Virginia, basically, but along the eastern coast as well, and Pennsylvania and Maryland. The Western theater, where was that? Very important. That was Tennessee, Kentucky, Mississippi, Georgia. So that's where Grant's career began in the Civil War. And he had a string of victories in the Western theater that included Shiloh, Tennessee, Vicksburg, Mississippi, and Chattanooga back in Tennessee. After those victories, he was promoted to Lieutenant General, and he was also, a little bit later, made General-in-Chief of the Armies of the United States of America and took over the strategic direction of the war. There are some seats up here in the front row if you want to come and make a spectacle of yourself. I'm just teasing. But now I'm ensuring that you're not going to do that. In the last year and a half of the fighting of Lee's army in the costly campaign known as the Overland Campaign, when he crossed the Rappahannock River in May of 1864, not late May, early May, and so his army went overland. His goal was to capture Richmond. That overland campaign, why they call it costly, resulted in terrible losses in such places as the Wilderness, at Spotsylvania, and at Cold Harbor in Virginia. With Lee's army bottled up inside of Petersburg, Virginia, Grant's two commanders, Generals William T. Sherman and Philip Sheridan, defeated Southern forces and destroyed Confederate property in Georgia, in South Carolina, and Virginia's Shenandoah Valley. Their victories helped to make possible the re-election of Abraham Lincoln in the fall of 1864. The war came to an end shortly after the fall of Petersburg and Richmond in April of 1865. Afterwards, Grant remained as head of the army, and in 1868, he was elected to the first of two terms as president on the Republican ticket. Grant never wanted to be president. He hated everything about being a politician. He hated the press frenzy. He hated the speech making. In fact, he didn't make very many speeches. He hated the glad handling and the extreme hypocrisy involved in every level. He was happy in his military job. He had four young children in 1866 and 1867. He looked forward to a lifetime of security in the peacetime army. Why did he become president? Andrew Johnson's disastrous attack, President Andrew Johnson, after Lincoln's assassination, disastrous attack on Reconstruction, on the heart of what it meant to win the Civil War, drew Grant's heated opposition and brought about a unanimous verdict for him at the Republican convention in 1868. Still, when he had to explain himself to his friends as, why are you doing this crazy thing, they asked him, he said that he had been, quote unquote, forced into accepting a nomination in spite of myself, he said. He did it, he said, because he was afraid the goals of the war, Union and emancipation, would be lost to what he called, quote unquote, mere trading politicians. He was proud of the fact that he was an unprofessional politician and entered the White House in 1869 without political experience, but with the warm support of a majority of citizens. Now, if Grant can only serve one term as president, perhaps the successes of his administration would be celebrated rather than scorned for his support of laws upholding civil rights, for his strong support in enabling the passage of the 15th Amendment guaranteeing the right to vote to African-American men, for his generous amnesty to former Confederates, for his reform program for Native Americans, for his peaceful settlement of grievances with England, culminating in the Treaty of Washington. This was over the Alabama claims. There were, of course, missteps in his first term, but nothing that occurred in his second term. In 1872, Grant, the first president to be reelected since Andrew Jackson, started the downhill fall that occurs to not just Grant, but the president in their second term. Scandals such as the whiskey ring threatened his administration and his reputation. A major depression struck the country in 1873, diminishing the Northern public's desire to continue what were by then unpopular Reconstruction policies, such as the interference in the Southern elections. In sum, Grant's political career proved frustrating and disappointing. People believed him to be honest and well-meaning, but he presided over an administration that suffered at times from corruption and bad management. Have you ever heard of a president presiding over an administration of corruption and bad management? From our point of view, that's part of the reason why Grant's presidential reputation needs to be revised a little bit. Retaining and regaining his immense popularity after 1876, he made a triumphant tour of the world from 1877 to 1879, which is really a fascinating part of his life that very few people know about. He went to every country in Europe. He went to India. He went to Egypt. He went to China. He went to Japan. It's an amazing story, and he was greeted by millions of people. He was the symbol for the world of the new American nation that emerged from the ashes of the Civil War. After his trip, Grant retired to New York City, where he lost his entire savings in an unwise financial venture, something that he had a close acquaintance with throughout his life. And he was reduced to a state of poverty. To earn money, he agreed to write about his wartime experience for a magazine called Century Magazine, very popular magazine back in the 19th century. And they were putting forth a series called Battles and Leaders. Grant's articles proved so popular that he decided to write his memoirs just as he was diagnosed with throat cancer. While dying of cancer in 1885, he courageously completed the writing of his autobiography, which was the final pages were written and revised right near here at his cottage at Mount McGregor, where he could go so easily. The publishing of his autobiography brought renewed reverence from many citizens, North and South, black and white. The two-volume personal memoirs of U.S. Grant, published by the firm of Mark Twain, called Webster & Company, sold 300,000 copies and earned $450,000 for his wife and his family, a huge amount if we put it in 2010 dollars. And I'm often asked if Mark Twain, the ghost, wrote Grant's memoirs. He did not. It would be much more funnier if Mark Twain wrote them, but they're, while they are infused with Grant's own dry wit, he wrote them all himself. When Ulysses S. Grant died on July 23, 1885, he was the most famous of all Americans, both at home and abroad. Indeed, more than 1.5 million people watched his funeral procession in New York City on August 8, 1885. The dedication of his massive tomb in Manhattan on the 75th anniversary of his birth on April 27, 1897, you will get a quiz. Dates after this, drew another 1 million-plus. That's hard to do. Grant's tomb in Manhattan is the largest tomb in North America. It remained New York City's most popular tourist site until the late 1920s. Grant's beautiful memorial sculpture in Washington, D.C. was dedicated on the 100th anniversary of his birth, April 27, 1922. His sculpture in D.C. is at the foot of Capitol Hill, facing down the mall toward Lincoln's Memorial. And it took 20 years to complete, and Grant's equestrian statue set in the middle of this huge sculpture is the second largest in the world. Now, even as Vice President Calvin Coolidge was praising Grant's legacy to the assembled crowd at the Capitol dedication ceremony in 1922, a constant drumbeat of criticism had already began to diminish Grant's reputation. Grant, the savior of his country, as he was known in the late 19th century, at least by most Northerners, had been supplanted in many people's minds by Grant the butcher, Grant the incompetent, corrupt president. How did this happen, and how was it so? Well, I have an answer, or else I wouldn't be giving this paper. Since the end of the war, ex-Confederates were busy writing history. Their version of history is known as the lost cause. The lost cause can be very simply defined. The cause of the war was not slavery. No, no. It was states' rights. Southern armies were never defeated, but rather overwhelmed by numbers. The Southern soldier was brave and true, echoing the perfection of the patron saint of the Lost Cause, Robert E. Lee. White Southerners thought of themselves as a wronged people. They managed to transform their defeat into a proud and defiant sense of their regional specialness and unique identity. Now, I'm fine with that so far, and I believe there are elements of the Lost Cause that are true, that are accurate, and that we have to acknowledge it. However, it's not enough, and it was not enough for the early Lost Cause historians to idolize Robert E. Lee. Ulysses S. Grant's reputation and the meaning of his cause, the Union cause, which the Union cause is the preservation of the Republic and emancipation after 1863. So the man and his cause had to be destroyed or at the very least diminished. To Lost Cause historians, whose influence, by the way, extended well beyond Southern boundaries, Grant was the enemy because he defeated Robert E. Lee. If they could not defeat Grant on the battlefield, they set out to tear him down in print. And that is what they did. The Lost Cause historians, writers, speakers portrayed Grant as a man of limited intelligence and inferior military skills. Let me give you an example. And I'm going to give you several examples, so bear with me. One of the Lost Cause, probably the most prominent one in the early days, was an ex-Confederate general and Lee aide named Jubal A. Early. And he summed up the attitude toward Grant with this famous speech that he gave, and this is a famous line from it, quote, "Shall I compare thee to his successful antagonist? As well compare the great pyramid which rears its majestic proportions in the valley of the Nile to a pygmy perched on Mount Atlas." All right, gotcha. I do not have time to describe in detail all the specific charges of the pro-Southern writers and speakers who were so influential in redirecting attention from Union victory and its meaning to glorifying Confederate defeat. Some were journalists, others were important military figures like Jubal Early, and all repeatedly attacked Grant's military record battle by battle. It's important that we understand that this happened. This is the way that reputations and historical memory are built by each generation. Let's just take a look very briefly at one publication that was very influential in shaping Grant's negative post-war reputation. It was written by the Southern journalist Edward Pollard. The book came out in 1866, and it was entitled The Lost Cause, very appropriately. So bear with me here again. I'm going to give you a few quotes. Now, Edward A. Pollard, Southern journalist who published this book called The Lost Cause, reviewed Grant's winning military record from 1861 onward, and his brilliant insight was this: Grant's victories had nothing to do with skill or intelligence, just greater resources. The Union general, Edward Pollard, contended, quote, "was one of the most remarkable accidents of the war. A man without any marked ability, certainly without genius, without fortune, without influence. What a loser. How did he end up winning, I wonder?" Pollard continued his damning assessment by claiming that Grant, quote, "contained no spark of military genius. His idea of war was to the last degree rude, no strategy. He had none of that quick perception," Pollard continued, "on the field of action, which decides it by sudden strokes. He had no conception of battle beyond the momentum of numbers," end of quote. In the end, Grant concluded, Pollard gathered all his vast resources to, quote, "conquer the little army, overcome the consummate skill of General Lee. And lacking the appreciation of high aims and intellectual exercises of war, Grant proposed to decide it by a mere competition in the sacrifice of human life," end of quote. Now, Pollard perfectly summed up the thrust of the harshest assessments of Grant's general. lacking fate or the incompetence of the Confederates. Although in reality, Grant's Western victories, including Vicksburg and Chattanooga, were low in terms of casualties. It was Shiloh, the one exception that was singled out, Shiloh in Tennessee, a very bloody battle in the spring of 1862, that was singled out by Lost Cause historians as a harbinger of Grant's willingness to sacrifice his men. Further, the story goes, Grant only prevailed in the all-important Eastern Theater because he possessed vast and unlimited resources. Some of these explanations depend still to this day on very controversial calculations on the comparative sizes and losses of the Army. And for those of you who are completely bored when it comes to military strategies and numbers, it's still very important to history and the history of the Civil War, and people debate about if a larger army can overwhelm a smaller army in all times and all places. So it's just about that. And Grant's reputation has been tarnished ever since the Lost Cause historians emerged, and I would argue they continue to influence the ways in which Grant has been remembered and has been written about in the history books. Just another notable example of this trend is provided to us by a great man of the 20th century, a man named Winston Churchill, who was an historian as well, many other things that he did. And he produced a three-volume history of the English-speaking peoples, in which he kindly included Americans. And he wrote about the Civil War. When it came to Grant, he wrote about Grant's quote-unquote unflinching butchery. That's pretty harsh, unflinching butchery, arguing, quote, that more is expected of the high command than determination in thrusting men to their doom. And Churchill ended his evaluation of Grant and his generalship by saying, when compared to the incomparable Lee, it must be regarded as the negation of generalship. Now, Winston Churchill was either the first nor the last historian to be perversely unaware that Lee lost proportionately more men than Grant in the Overland Campaign of 1864, which pitted the top generals against each other, and which I had mentioned before. In fact, both generals directed campaigns that produced huge casualty rates. Butcher Lee is equally applicable to that noble and gentlemanly warrior, especially if we compare Grant's casualty rates against Lee's. Let's compare those rates between 1862 and the eve of this Overland campaign. What were they? At Belmont, at Fort Henry and Fort Donelson, at Shiloh, at Vicksburg and Chattanooga, historians have totaled up Grant's casualties at approximately 35,000 killed, wounded, and missing. In contrast, Lee's casualty rates, remember this is before the Overland campaign, from 7 days, Second Manassas, the Maryland campaign, Fredericksburg, Chancellorsville, and the Pennsylvania campaign, totaled 90,000. And if you want to know the losses in the Overland campaign, Grant's losses were much more than Lee's. It numbered 126,000 to Lee's 70,000. But because Union forces outnumbered the rebels by 2-1, Lee's relative butchery was much greater. In fact, if we really want to be immature, we can look for generals in the Civil War who were not butchers. And when we look for them, we turn to our shining star, which would be General George B. McClellan, who really was beloved by his men, who didn't want to fight those battles so that so many men would be killed, that Southern property would be killed. But he made the war go on longer. No end was in sight at the end of Antietam, and that's why Lincoln had to let him go. For the South, we look to General Joe Johnston, who perfected the use of backward maneuvers to keep his casualty rates low. So we have to put these things in perspective. But in the 20th century, as Churchill's comments underscore, understanding or appreciation of the Union cause steadily declined against the partly mythic appeal of white Southern mobility and romanticism. It seems, I know, every time I teach a Civil War class at UCLA, I have to explain carefully to my students why it was that the Northern people sacrificed so much so that the United States could remain whole. In contrast, it seems if you read the Southern point of view in history, the warfare conducted by U.S. Grant, Butcher, Drunk, and above all else, Lucky, is repellent because it has been deemed modern. Much of Grant's military reputation, as I mentioned before, boils down to the meaning imparted to his ability to command overwhelming numbers. In other words, the more men, the less the soldier. Some would say it's the easy way out. You look at the relative strength and resources in every possible category, north or south, in 1861, and if that's all you look at, you would say, well, I know that the North was going to win. And then you say, oh, it took 4 years and 650,000 deaths. And so you realize that it's not just all about numbers. Military historians have long demonstrated the defensive advantage of holding the interior lines in the Civil War, such as the Army of Northern Virginia enjoyed in Virginia. You're on your home ground, you have a tight line, and the bigger army is on the defensive. The bigger army has a disadvantage. The smaller army is advantage. Part of Lee's greatness lies in his ability to use these interior lines to his advantage. People often fail to see or to understand that Grant's commanding a large army, the Army of the Potomac, and directing several other large armies, and the whole national effort, Sherman's army, and the Army of the Shenandoah Valley, might have also... I'm just too excited for this microphone. Can you hear me in the back?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So I would ask, what about the challenge of maneuvering the slow, huge, bulky Army of the Potomac into the dense, forested thickets of the area known as the Wilderness? What about the challenge of stepping into a very troubled command structure of the Army of the Potomac? Grant came from the West. He was a winner in the West. No Confederate army or general could withstand the power of Grant and his armies in the West, but he came east in March and April and May of 1864, and he was put in charge of an army he knew nothing about. So that was something to consider. Is it not something to direct a national effort, a force of nearly a million men? At least one famous World War II general agreed. In 1944, Dwight D. Eisenhower remarked, quote, Grant devised a strategy to end the war. He alone, said Eisenhower, had the determination, the foresight, and the wisdom to do it. In his memoirs, Grant was very keenly aware, it's almost a very tender part of his memoirs in which he said that it really matters to me that future Americans, because in part in his memoirs, he was contending with critics such as Jubal Early, critics in the North as well. It mattered to him that future generations of Americans could be confused or would forget about or downplay the hardships of the Union Army and the accomplishment of winning the war, thus preserving the United States and bringing freedom to all sections. Well, Grant became president, and the historians of the Lost Cause have their say about that too. Reconstruction's bitter recriminations also shaped the low esteem in which his administration has been held. White Southerners and Northern Democrats condemned and worked against constantly Grant's attempts to ensure freedom's rewards to African Americans. And the earliest group of academic historians writing, those historians who got their PhDs, the first PhD program at Johns Hopkins University in the 1880s, and then it just followed, and then you have what we have today, professional historians who have PhDs. And the first generation was led by a man named William Dunn. Lunning of Columbia University. He was a Southerner. He was imbued with lost cause ideology and beliefs growing up, and then he brought it to his scholarly work. He was an excellent scholar, but he portrayed Grant in the history books as a cold-blooded killer during the Civil War and a dictator during Reconstruction. And we can see that in the film Birth of a Nation. We can see that ideology at work in one of my favorite movies, Gone with the Wind. And they, you see the way that academic historians, a prominent historian such as William Dunning and his many, many students who went on to be historians in the 20s and 30s and 40s, how they influenced the textbooks. Most modern presidential rankings confirm Grant's low estimation in the scholarly community. For example, a survey of historians in 1994 placed Grant 38th, securely ahead of only a truly bunch of pathetic losers such as James Buchanan, Andrew Johnson, and Warren Harding. Another such poll, taken in the year 2000, recorded only a slight increase for Grant's presidency at 32nd, vaulting him in front of such mediocrities as Calvin Coolidge, Chester Arthur, and Benjamin Harrison. Now, I hope there's no descendants. I know Chet Arthur is a favorite of you guys, and I actually like Benjamin Harrison, but anyway, they're not ranked highly, but Grant is usually in the bottom cluster, although he is rising in the most recent presidential rankings. For example, a recent CNN poll had him at number 23, and I'm going to talk about that in a few minutes, the possibility that his reputation might have changed. Grant's low presidential rankings during the 20th century are complemented by popular assumptions of his drunkenness. You were wondering when I was going to get to this. Even though scholars have diligently separated fact from fiction, separated rumors from truth, and defend Grant against those who would unfairly denigrate his reputation. I think probably the definitive last word on Grant's drinking has been researched and written up. Yes, it seems he did have a binge or two during the war, but exhaustive evidence shows that Grant rarely imbibed and never when it counted. This is a vexing issue, I can tell you. Nothing I will write or say will change it. But I do believe, again, we have to be mature about judging our history, judging our presidents and other leaders. Most of our leaders, most of our great men and women suffer from flaws. And if I look at Winston Churchill, who was so harsh on Grant, he was known to enjoy his drink as well. And in fact, he was accused many times of being a drunk. And I always turn that question around, which I get every time, or almost every time I talk to a group, so please don't ask it this time. But was Grant a drunk? I say, well, what do you think of Abraham Lincoln? Well, most people think very highly of Abraham Lincoln. In those same presidential polls, Lincoln is number one almost always, maybe trading places with George Washington one or another year. But would Abraham Lincoln appoint a drunken man to lead the army? And the answer, of course, is no. But this stereotype is nonetheless perpetuated endlessly in popular culture, and it has been for a long time. A relatively early example is James Thurber's classic parody, If Grant Had Been Drinking at Appomattox. I don't know if any of you are old enough to remember James Thurber or to remember the December 1930 issue of The New Yorker when it came out. I was just a little kid. Anyway, I'm going to tell you about this. It's really hilarious, and James Thurber is brilliant. So James Thurber's little parody begins with a hungover Grant preparing for the fateful surrender meeting with Lee. He mistakes Lee for the poet Robert Browning. Then, bracing for the occasion, takes another swig of his from his whiskey bottle. Quote, slowly, sadly, he unbuckled his sword. Then he handed it to the astonished Lee. There you are, General, said Grant. We damn near licked you. If I had been feeling better, we would have licked you. Some Civil War movies, such as John Ford's The Horse Soldiers, feature, which was in 1959, feature the general with a glass of whiskey glued to his side. Now, I don't know about you, but I enjoy watching the Turner Classic Movie Channel. I love old movies, I always have. And many times I'll be watching an old movie and I'll see a reference to Grant's Tomb or U.S. Grant. And about 3 months ago, I was watching a Going My Way, which is a movie that was produced in the 1940s with Bing Crosby playing a priest. And in one of the scenes, Crosby's character is looking for a drink for a priest, another priest who was in need. And the priest said, well, I have a secret stash of whiskey tucked away on my bookshelf. And as you follow Bing Crosby's hand, he pulls the liquor out from behind a book called The Life of General Grant. So this is something that's very deeply embedded in our culture from a long time ago. Television has also provided fodder for Grant the Drunk. In an episode of the highly rated, just imagine my having to do this research now. In an episode of a highly rated series many years ago, The Beverly Hillbillies, called The South Rises Again in 1867, the character Granny spies actors from a Civil War movie, including one portraying an inebriated General Grant. I could give you lots of examples. I'll stop with this one, which was drawn to my attention by my son, who was watching an episode of the animated series The Family Guy. The Family Guy presented a bizarre reenactment of Appomattox, in which Grant, wielding the bottle of whiskey, shouts insults at General Lee. After a struggle, Confederate victory is declared, at which point a member of the crowd stood up to defend the Northern general in this cartoon episode. He said, that drunken idiot kicked your sorry asses. Excuse my French, but you get the idea. Almost every Civil War professor can testify, even in this day and age when many students coming from grammar school or high school don't really learn about too much about presidents or generals, one of the most commonly asked questions from students was Ulysses S. Grant the Drunk. Movie makers in the late 20th and early 21st century largely ignored the Union hero. Grant, in fact, has not appeared as a substantial character in a film that I can remember since the Western epic of the early 1960s, How the West Was Won. Grant has fared even worse in a flourishing Civil War.
Character
visit historical sites devoted to Grant's. Grant's Manhattan tomb was described by one observer as the least appreciated national monument in the country. It was defaced by graffiti, it was a hangout for drug dealers and muggers, and its visitation rates plunged in the 1970s and 80s. The National Park Service, responding to a chorus of protests, embarked on a $1.8 million restoration campaign and a restoration project. It was finished in time for the 100th anniversary of Grant's birthday, April 27, 1997. However, I have visited it many times, both before and after the renovation, and it is clear that the visitation levels are going to remain low, nothing like they were in the old days. The strong connection of Grant's image in popular culture is also reflected in academic works, which is very interesting to me because it's not always true. For example, I think most Americans who care about history really admire Theodore Roosevelt. Roosevelt, who's had his reputation savaged by professional historians. You took a class in which Theodore Roosevelt appeared today at a major university, would be a very different Theodore Roosevelt from the one that is in popular culture. But Grant seems to come together. He's low in among academics and low in popular culture. And that is true. That is true from the beginning. It wasn't just lost cause historians. Henry Adams, the historian of the late 19th century and a grandson of a descendant of two presidents, felt that Grant was a symbol for the post-war American. This is what Henry Adams said: "The progress of evolution from President Washington to President Grant was alone evidence to upset Darwin. Adams described Grant as pure energy without intellect. Many other prominent historians writing in the 1920s, 30s, and 40s followed Adams' interpretation, adapted, even if unconsciously, the Dunning School, the Lost Cause School, emphasizing only the scandalous parts of Grant's administration and his generalship. Distinguished writer of a widely used textbook, a man named Vernon L. Harrington, every school child read his textbook for much of the 20th century, or some version of it. He summed up the common historical wisdom about Grant, claiming that Grant possessed only a dull, plebeian character and was, quote, unintellectual and unimaginative, devoid of ideas and with no tongue to express the incoherent emotions that surged daily in his heart." Well, how did he know they were incoherent? That these incoherent emotions surge daily in his heart, I don't know, but it's kind of a stunning statement in a widely read and used textbook. Now, the generation of historians who followed along, each generation of historians change the way history is taught. They undertake revision and reappraisals, and they did it after World War I and after World War II. And in both of those reappraisals, Grant continued his downward plunge in American history. For example, just to give you an example, I think it's interesting. We think that history is a story and it's set in stone, but it's not true. It can be interpreted in many different ways. After World War I, people were sick of war in America. The war to end all wars was not a war to end all wars. It was a needless war, in many historians' opinions. And Grant's reputation suffered from that. The collapse of the American economy, the 1930s singled out robber barons. Grant presided over this great, huge expansion of the American economy. He was seen to be in bed with many wealthy men. He became a symbol of a corrupt and materialistic era. And so this has echoed throughout the years and is with us today. But I would say that it's time for a change. Surely, as the eminent Grant scholar John Simon observed, this image of Grant as general and president is so out of date now. It's, even though it represents the tone of current historical literature. Surely, a theory of an inevitable union victory based on numbers and industrial capacity cannot hold water after Vietnam. Surely, a portrait of the shockingly corrupt Grant administration requires readjustment after Watergate, after Whitewater, after the recent Wall Street and Fannie Mae scandals. Surely, a few historians might note that under Grant's presidency, black political participation and biracial governments in the South appeared in levels unprecedented in our history or even world history, and certainly was unequal for almost 100 years after. Surely these largely negative interpretations no longer square with the newer scholarship, the newer history that is emerging. It remains to be seen if a wider audience will accept a reconsideration of Grant's generalship and presidency, and that is what I want to address in my conclusion. And I want to just mention four what I call trend-setting biographies and biographical studies published between 1997 and 2004 represent the way of the future, I think, to a more positive, not saying that Grant's presidency was great or amazing or perfect, of course not, but a more positive assessment of his presidency and his generalship as well. And they are Jeffrey Corray's Ulysses S. Grant Soldier, Brooks D. Simpson's Ulysses S. Grant's Triumph Over Adversity, his second volume of Grant's life is coming out soon on his presidency, Gene Edward Smith's Grant, published in 2001, and a very nice, slender volume by Josiah Bunting, which appeared in 2004 in a presidential series called Ulysses S. Grant. It's easy to write a book for Grant. The title is right there for you. So I want to fuse their findings and add a little bit of my own in my conclusion. What does this new work do? What does it give us a preview of? I think it's providing a balanced and convincing major reappraisal both of Grant's military career and his post-war years. And I just have to give a plug to the 31 volumes of the U.S. Grant presidential papers that were edited by John Y. Simon and the late John Y. Simon, which are now being edited by John Marsalek. And for the first time, I have all 31 volumes. It's a presidential library on your bookshelf. And what it did was to draw together a massive amount of previously scattered Grant material. It's all there. For these scholars, the scholars that I just mentioned, and historians and myself, Grant does not emerge suddenly as a brilliant orator or a dazzling politician. Rather, they claim that too many previous historians have magnified his flaws and underestimated his strength, creating a very distorted record for him in the history book. Like Julius Caesar, they say, Grant always moved forward and grappled with obstacles head on. There's something to that. Some new scholars have argued that Grant was possessed of an unusual capability for calm objectivity in the depth of war's chaos. He made forceful and keen strategic decisions that demonstrated, quote, that rare combination of those qualities of character and mind that make for a great commander. Far from an unimaginative butcher who relied only on numbers to win, these historians argue that Grant exemplified the traits of leadership, mastery of men, logistics, and strategy that explained his emergence as a winning general of the Civil War. Perhaps most important for a general, asserts one of these authors, he was willing to make decisions and live with the consequences, sustained, as William T. Sherman once said, by a constant faith in victory. Grant's post-war career impresses this group of revisionists as much as the years of Union command. They remind readers that except for Lincoln and maybe FDR, Grant shouldered more grave responsibilities and crises than any other chief executive in our history, dealing with a massively complicated job of reconstructing the nation, which can be described as a final stage in the conflict between the two sections, as well as the serious economic depression. In my lecture, I end my Civil War class with a lecture on Reconstruction that I entitled Waging Peace. We go from waging war to waging peace because it was really hard and bloody and violent as well. More and more of these revisionists that I spoke of building on the work of academic scholarship for the past 30 years that has completely turned on its head the old idea of Reconstruction. They now realize that Grant operated amid intensely racist forces, both in the South and the North, that militated against any sweeping reform to assist African Americans. Northern white people considered that the main goal of the war, saving the Union, was more important than ensuring equality for blacks. In fact, studying Grant's campaign against the Ku Klux Klan and other actions, historians now find far more commitment to African Americans in the president than his people in the North were willing to give. In short, Grant is emerging in these history books as a thoughtful, intelligent, engaged president, fully aware of the responsibilities, duties, and difficulties inherent in the role of chief executive. Throughout his presidency, Grant remained steadfast in the belief that the goals of the war should be preserved, even as the country's enthusiasm for Reconstruction faded away.